Rome. Ma è topico. Mi permesso di nudare, lo sanno. Mi dispiace per te. Tanto costa il poi. Question is, why do we not have cross-cultural missionaries anymore? In the past, of course, we know that South Sea Island missionary sending nation, and then they all mission died, and then first I will come up with the reason why we don't have cross-cultural missionaries, and second, am I looking to some great strategies and to see if these strategies can be relevant to the Samoan context. And third, was to conclude with the idea of this strategy can be fit or not. And the question is, what is the reason why Samoan is not able? Yeah. Well, there are a lot of reasons in the past, but one could be a poor leadership, second, lack of training, no more interesting mission. Third can be they are full of the gospel. Full of the gospel means they will eat and they were full and they're roaming all of the gospel. No need to send out no more interesting mission. And lastly, the need of really choose into missions again. So these are the reasons why I think we don't have a cross-culture missionary sending to abroad. So another question is, what can be the excellent way to put mission in the mindset of our people and the idea of recruiting and training again and sending out missionaries like in the past? So we need to do that in the future. And here are some of the ideas, mobilizing, regrouping, you know, like you put together a group of people. This is another one, recruiting missionaries. This could be the school of mission and so forth. And third, allowing missionaries from the field to share their testimony, what mission is like, what is being missionary, and what is being ministered to across culture and another land different from this comfort zone. So come down to what can be a good strategy to reach out more again with mission. What? First, find a way to teach their missions again into the churches. Second, can we use Sunday school any opportunity to educate them? Right? Use missions in the cross-cultural setting ministry. And the third, we need to learn from the past. We need to learn from the past what we did learn and what happened and what did we miss and what caused mission dying in the islands. Fourth, so here I came up with four strategies because I'm from the Assembly of God. So I look into the Assembly of God. There is a book, journal. So in, these strategies are from these journals. And most of these four strategies are from four missionaries. They were missionaries in different parts of the world. So why is so called like this? So the first one is about the four pillars of mission strategy. And by Ross Turner. Ross Turner is a missionary in the Philippines. He's a professor at traveling professor for MPGS, and he's based in Manila. So in his book, he come up with four pillars of he believes that he use in missions. And the second person is Richard Nicholson. So he's also a missionary in somewhere in Africa. So planting, he was focusing on planting God's plan for expanding the kingdom. And the third one, training, cultivating the churches, harvest by Mike McLeathy, and touch a perspective on the compassion ministry by Ron Maddox. So these are the four strategic programs bring up by these missionaries. I believe this can be very helpful and for my people back at home. So Ross Turner, he came up with the reaching proclaiming the message of hope. First, I was thinking of reaching, planting, training, and touching. So these four categories, the four pillars he was talking about, the mission strategy. He said he was kind of like define a mission with four words, reaching, planting, training, and touching. So these four are not separated according to this missionary. Hindu credit and comprehensive God-given plan. So they present these four activities for all missionaries to evangelize and establish churches, training national churches leaders, and demonstrating Christ's compassion to the poor and the suffering people. So these four biblical mandates we sort of strive to obey a strong and mature indigenous church, participate in and support each of these four. So that's the idea, to participate. And come down to the four ways, the four pillars of mission strategy. For me, I look at that these four ways has already been happening in my country, because in the past, we reached people. You know, early missionaries came a long time ago in 1930, so to 1935, to 1945. Planting, of course, they plant first school in 1839, mission training center. And after they plant, they train. So train, after many of these guys will be trained, and they offer their life to missions they keep. So that's when we send South Sea missions. And touch here, I think he spoke about to how to establish self-supporting, self-protecting, and self-covering of local churches. So another touching pillar, he presented the three self-supporting means. Self-supporting is to have a resource to be able to survive without the outside assistance. So we didn't want to allow the aid from abroad. We just want to survive on our own. Self-protecting is in vision numbers, so we take to increase. And self-governing, we have the idea of self-control, the control of, and I think this is where the early agencies are more dry and dying because of this method. So the great example as they touch life is like a coach player. You hope in the game and show them how to achieve it. So you as a coach, not only you describe them how to achieve and how to be done. So, B, planting by Richard Nixon. So, God's plan for expanding the kingdom. So in this strategy, according to the author, he kind of like defined, he stated that church planting is not a collection of individual believers of a group of people, but it's also a transmission of new life from one group of believers to another. So while teaching a church planting evangelism course at the River Plain Bible Institute in Pernod in Hartington, and then he said, his core in his teaching, he taught his student this phrase, just start somewhere along the way. So after he planned, trust the Holy Spirit and work hard, and the church will grow. That's his method. The miracle of a church planting, in fact, there may be it not be a church in a community today, but tomorrow a person will be plant one. It may start small, but it might be enough big and grow. So, Richard Nixon, he came up with five guidelines of principle of church planting. One, church planting is an indispensable to evangelize, and is in the heart, passion, and the plan of God, and the existence of the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of this world. Second, just plant up will be experienced miraculous provision of the Spirit. God will be able to partner, bring partners, and release resources that will be help accomplish the task. And just planting, third, can be spontaneous, but it is primarily intentional, intentional. It is often the result of the vision and passion of the church or people who is committed to partnering the specific group or community. It involves sharing the gospel, investing financial resources, praying, releasing family and team members in participation, accessing, planning without clearly focused, and committing to help make the church's plan successful. The fourth one, a church planter is a parent figure. You know, it's who receive his reward as he participates in the miracle of the congregational that will demonstrate kingdom in the community where he's planted. The last one we saw, church planting is an evangelism. Where one plants in the inner city or for the interstate or the rural area, reaching unreached people through planting a church, which is the field of a lifetime and worth every effort and investment. So according to this guy, Nicholson, he also said that church leaders have say concerning the four pillars, evangelism, church planting, training, and compassion ministry, that almost all religious groups participate in evangelism, compassion ministry. So this is the four that he will be helpful. So in order he gave us these guidelines of church planting, but to help ministry grow, so especially in mission. So the third one, training cultivating the church, harvest by Mike McGriffin. So in this setting, he came up with the idea of it is one of Christ's insightful discourse found in, I think, John chapter 4, 34, 38. He balanced the need for the evangelistic endurance of verse 35 and 36 with an ongoing awareness for those who earlier worked and had made significant contribution to the advance of the kingdom. So verse 37 and 38, in the team effort in missions, we need to accept the fact that we stand on shoulders of others. So in under this strategy came up the idea, the crop juicing process can be divided into four categories. One, starting and preparation. Second, planting. Third, cultivation. Fourth, harvest. So he used the term here, cultivation in the church, means he referring to the farming and in that process. So if he said, if we link human activity, skills, and personality to these four categories, we would have the grid to look something like this one, land preparation, inclusiveness, insightfulness, strategy. Second, planting can be timelessness, availability, and cultivation can be patient and the endurance and acceptness and thoroughness, and harvest urgency and travel. So in this arena, he said that the probable, that the parallel process of cultivation take place in the church, we call cultivation training. So in this process, it's called cultivation training. So harvest, whether it's scriptural context or related to the ebb and flow in the life events, usually indicates the planting, followed by an activity that results in a benefit of reward. So of the four faiths mentioned above, none requires more patience instead of the cultivation. Cultivation involves spacing, growing plants, removing weeds, preparing soil and air, and so forth, and applying fertilizing. So it's all about the process of farming. So according to Michael, he stated, and in a strategy designed by the Holy Spirit, established local, there we go, the self-propagating, the self-supporting, and the self-covering. So and then B, touching ministry, touching perspective in comparison in ministry by long methods. In forming a, in this process, he said, forming a basis for compassion outreach, he said, we must consider these 3 points. So according to the author, he discovered that the gospel must be always include a demonstration of the love of Christ. So he said, he came to realize that while Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost, was in Luke 19, verse 30, I think in James. And he said, his life and ministry demonstrate the love and the compassion of God. Yeah. So Jesus addressed in Luke 4, 18, 19, serve as a model for the spirit and power mission. As Pentecostal, we equipped to perform ministry, compassion while maintaining proper focus on evangelism. Yeah, so under this category, the 3 point, Jesus' ministry was ministry of compassion. Jesus' vision or statement include compassion and ministry. Jesus' ministry was spiritual empowered. So the author discovered that the gospel must include demonstrating the love of Christ. Yes. So in this category, Jesus' ministry was a ministry of compassion. Out of 36 recorded miracles of Jesus, 33 were a miracle of compassion. So we saw that in the book of John, the turn of the wine into a turn of the water into wine. It just revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. Compassionate miracle reveals the nature of God and glory and still faith. The second one, Jesus' business statement includes compassion ministry. Under this category, it's a ministry of Jesus and ours. It's a ministry to foster poor, spiritual and economic, prisoners, captive, sinners, blind, those who are blind spiritually, sharing the truth, those with the gospel, physical, blind, and depressed by the devil. The last one, Jesus' ministry model was perfect, plan of the spirit and power, evangelism, compassion. So here, the author, he brought up the book of Luke, the spirit of God was upon Jesus because he was anointed. So to preach the good news to the poor, the prisoner. So here is where he the confirmation the second one. So the third one is Jesus' ministry was spirit and power. So we need the power of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was baptized by John, and the voice from heaven, he said, "You are my son, whom I love, with whom I am well pleased." So we need power. We need to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. We have the gospel in our hands. We will go with the passionate, but we need to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. That's why this guy was amazed. He said, "We need to be empowered by the Spirit." So another important question after these four strategies, I was saying another important question is how to recruit missionaries. If that's the case, so I look into the book by Paul Seger, Sanders, how your church can identify, train, deploy missionaries. So in this book, the author provides nine dynamic, powerful elements to help our churches to recruit missionaries. So I feel, and I believe, this must be better as a starting point for me or for whoever prepared to start missions again where I come from. So the center focus of this book is is to provide a practical, helpful, kind aim at the local churches who should be center of missionaries. So this book is an attempt to help churches to identify, train, send the next generation of missionaries. So, and here are the nine vital and powerful elements. First, training missionaries, identifying who should be sent. The prerequisites of sending churches, the role of parallel churches organization. Parallel churches include the smaller like YWAM, YFC, and so forth. Choosing mission agency, we have a lot of a mission agency. The place of funding missionaries. Yeah, that is where the church or whoever our sponsors are going to find. The place of them making, yeah, this is where you come up with the idea of you have a secular work as a part of a certain meeting. That's the eighth one, how to pray for missionaries. Yeah, that's a good one. And like specific ways to promote missions. So these nine powerful elements by Seger in his book Center. Seger strongly encouraged the local churches to become proactive in sending and supporting missionaries. So not only sending but also supporting. To do so, they must be deliberate strategy, and they take center stage of this topic of mission. So churches should begin with examining the purpose of the system, and once identified, the local church should wrap up it all and test around this purpose statement and to communicate it often and well or his member. Center, in this book, is a helpful and practical manual which will aid any church to bring into focus why it exists to make disciples and how it can extend in this purpose through local outreach. And lastly, conclusion. So, I came to conclusion every and hope that this four strategy I was showing earlier will help me or help might be work to solve this issue in Samoa and some islands of the Pacific, where the region I come from. The heartbeat of God is mission, but it's all. But if I'm not called to mission and no one is helping churches to reach other and to train them, disciple them, to teaching them is useless. You know, it's a useless process. In fact, it is our duty to remember well and to fulfill the Great Commission. Jesus himself said, to send them to reach us. So we train them, we reach them, we train them, and then we send them out. So according to Paul, he stated, missions has its origin in the heart of God. God is founded on a sending love. So this is the deepest source of missions. It is impossible to penetrate a deeper still. There is mission because God loves people. In Jesus' name, Amen. God.